Vì ai thức là châu By your sweet princess Zilka.
To record this again. I don't want to. I mean, think about it again and again. Isn't it enough that I feel so horrible? I miss me, Princess Zilka. Here I am. That makes 4 episodes in 7 hours. I am going to recover. I am pushed to record it. I would not. I never did. I don't know, because it's just not so nice to listen to. I don't want to. Drowning, screaming I am. But I recover first. That's what I said in the previous video. That's how I am. Crying and I recover fast. Because I don't want to think about the horror. I just don't want to. And if I can possibly be distracted, I like to. And now you want me to talk more about Carlos. Okay, I do that. Yesterday, the Atacalacho, which I uploaded this morning from yesterday, I talked about Carlos in the last videos. I said he was a knight. I just didn't know the name in English. Because it's horse in German. It's also very Springer, maybe that too. Springer, someone who jumps. But Springer is also the press, the general press in Germany. I think right underneath Reuter, which brings all the news. So, Carlos, I think about, well, relationships, right? What could we have done? But I can't if he doesn't look. All he ever was? I don't know. I have so little memory about it. But it was so little time that I saw him. I mean, I can count on one hand, maybe. He had a very special smile. Because in a way he was detached. He was never a womanizer, ever. But he was a peopleizer. I mean, he had always people around him. Young boys, right? I forgot. When I met him, he was still studying at La Ibero. And I was working or intending to find a job. Oh, actually, I was working. And it seemed like we were like boyfriend and girlfriend, but in a way he did not really follow up on it. I think his friends thought so. I don't know, he was kind of... See, it's... I said it yesterday, it's so simple. To have or to be. And I think he just wanted to have experience. I don't know what he wanted, honestly. And he didn't want to really dive into it, or maybe he didn't know how. Okay, I have one memory which may affirm the statement that he was kind of protected in his house. that he was like family oriented. He never said a word. But in a way, it could maybe explain, why did he not pursue me? Maybe his mother is very active in showing her love, that he didn't know that he actually had to do anything. Because I don't do anything, you guys, my people. I don't go and call. I don't claim him mine. He has to claim me his. I cannot do that. He has to give me the certainty what it is he wants for me to feel okay and safe. I do never go one step ahead or one step further. I just watch and observe what he does. And if I like, I am with. So I have the feeling we never really got off the stage where we actually, the initiating stage where we got to kind of know each other. Okay, in Puerto Escondido, in New Year's, that was kind of a miracle because I must have just met him before. I met him in a place, in a club. Yeah, that was the time I went like 4 times to a club because it was special. It was not a dumb club. It was just a dance place. The one where was this bartender who was introduced to me. It was like very paternal. He had a family. So I felt like I was safe standing there at the bar when I wouldn't be dancing. What's his name again? Calixto, yes. Okay, so that was a special place. It was not very large. And it had better music than any other place. And it wasn't for idiots. And someone must have brought me there. I don't know who. Some girlfriend. But she also introduced me to the bartender. And I felt like I could go back because I like dancing and the dance floor was not really large, but it was very well equipped with the sound system. So when I wouldn't be dancing, I could stay next to Calixto at the bar, which was lit. And I would be safe because no one would like attempt on me. So of course I met a few people. I met, what's his name? The one who broke his leg, the catering. He came and talked to me. Just people came and talked. Maybe they knew him too. I don't know. The Calixto guy. Maybe I went 4 times. Maybe only 3. I don't know. And one time, Carlos came and he talked to me. And he was always like with other people. He was very tall. Taller than I am. But he had this special smile. He did just, you know, he had attempted people as friends. So I had the feeling me too. And that's a good entrance. So there I met him. And the next time I went to his house. He invited me to his house. I don't think anybody was there. It was in the evening. A very large living room and a very wide street as well. I don't know, maybe Colonia del Valle. I don't remember, but it was a good place. Like potentially at the time for me the best ever, because the freaking snobs, they're not really for me. I mean, I don't really like them. I mean, the neighborhoods are nicer, but the people are vain and stupid. Snobs. Okay, let's go talk snobs now. No, I'm recovering. So, fresas, that's the Mexican term. It stands for strawberries, but that's the type of person who speaks different and drives nice cars and has poppy, you know, daddy who has got money. They live in like, yeah, cool and modern neighborhoods. I like the neighborhoods, they're good. Not the old money, but the kind of new rich, so to speak. I might translate them into snobs, but not like the traditional term of snob. Because the traditional term of snob comes from Europe. And those are people who eat fine dining. They like it a lot because they're refined. They wear nice clothing. They wear nice attachments to the clothing, right? And watches and I don't know. And they have culture. They know about architecture. They know about literature. They know about a lot of things. That's why they're snobs, because they're better. than the rest of the population because they studied a lot and learned a lot. And then if I want to go with La Plebe, with the Blanc Stupe, it also has to do with education, because in that world, you know how to behave, you have elegant. In that world, when you have dinner, when you go proper dinner, then you have like many courses and have nice conversations. In that environment, you never slash on each other. You're never vulgar, you never scream at anybody. You don't fight with people. Get it? So they have like the good stuff of life. They have it for coming from themselves. Because they studied a lot, they learned all that. I am not a snob, but the lifestyle is perfect for me. But I am not exclusive. I also can go with anybody else from any other social stratus to hang out. See, I'm not a snob, and snobs just don't do that. And in Mexico, the fresas, yes, they are not cultivated. They have no interest in anything. They do not do fine dining. They do not wear nice clothing. I mean, yeah, but regular, just anybody else. Yeah, maybe that Levi's jeans, for example. No, they don't wear Naco jeans. I don't know exactly what they wear. But they have nothing special going on. Only the thing that they feel that they're better, because the puppy has money. So those are the people who are supposed to be at La Ibero. Maybe the main part of those were in La Ibero. But I'm not interested in those because they have nothing to offer. The only thing they have is money, and they don't have the money, it's their parents. So Carlos was looking up to them because he studied at La Ibero. And for me, where he lived and his upbringing was potentially so much more interesting, or actually ideal. Because people who have interest in what I just told you, the snobs have, they come from the intellectual circles, and those usually don't live in the neighborhoods where the fresas live. Those come from neighborhoods like where Carlos lived. They're simpler, they don't have like attitudes. They know that their richness is inside and they can learn and study. Because it's beautiful to know about literature and art and poetry and lots of things. It's just part of, you know, good cinematography. It's just part of life to make it nice. So Carlos received me in his house, and it was a wide, large living room. I was there, I don't know, for a while. And yes, there, I remember, he kissed me, I remember that. So that must have been the start. And then he came once to my apartment and brought me a cassette. And right afterwards, he invited me to go to Puerto Escondido with him. Because he and his friends would go. Come, he said. And I didn't have a sleeping bag, he must have brought me one. Because we crashed on the floor, the entire crew. I don't know, 20 people maybe? I don't remember. Could be 15 or, yeah, maybe. I don't know. Or more. So, next to the beach. Interesting enough, I never remembered that event when I went later to Puerto Escondido. I never remembered it. Or I never looked for the house. Maybe I did. Maybe I didn't. Maybe I saw it. I don't know. It's not important. It was an unfinished building. In Spanish, it's called obra gris. It's like when you have like cement and you have all the bricks and everything, but the walls are not finished. It's all gray. Yeah, someone's mother, I think, owned it. So the miracle about going there was that it was around Christmas. And he told me very short notice. And I went to the bus station and actually got a ticket, and that was like absolutely impossible at that time. There was one ticket left to Puerto Escondido, like meant for me. That was such a miracle that there would be one ticket. So I took the bus. I don't think we were allowed, I was there for long. Because in New Year's Eve, we returned, and I remember that because I was now returning with him and his younger brother. His younger brother wasn't as tall as he was. Not to me, Carlos was handsome. But he was very brown. Dark skin. I like dark skin. I think his brother was less dark skinned. Maybe Carlos had an issue with that in Mexico. So here we are driving now. And I wonder, how does the bus go to Puerto Escondido? I don't remember. I must have taken overnight. Because you can go from Cuernavaca. Oh wait, I was living in Mexico City at the time. You can go via Acapulco and then take the coastal route. Or you can go from Mexico City straight to Oaxaca, the capital of Oaxaca, and then go down to the coast. So I don't know which route the bus took, but I don't remember having stopped at Oaxaca. So it's on many hours. I have no clue how many, 14 maybe? 12? I have no idea. It's a long ride. But on our way back, I rode with Carlos and his younger brother in a small car. I think it was a Caribe, like mine. Those are fast, these little suckers. Volkswagen Caribe. Yeah, Volkswagen. It's like the previous version of the Golf. And I remember that when it was turned for his brother to drive, that's the only part I remember. No, I did not drive. They both drove, but I did not. But when it was his brother's turn, he drove like crazy bitch, super fast, because he said, I want to be for New Year. Yeah, for New Year, I want to be home with my family. And Carlos said, but it's impossible. Don't hurry. We exited too late. But he did not pay attention, his younger brother. I don't know his name. I barely remember how he looks, not even slightly. But he, this younger brother, drove like crazy shit, for hours on end, way too fast, because he wanted to arrive to his parents' house. I don't even know what age Carlos was, 24 maybe? So his younger brother was a little younger. So the issue is that because his brother was so homesick, right? And of course we did not arrive on time. I have no clue. No, yes, was somewhere on the highway. I have no clue where. Oh, and he took the route from Puerto Escondido to Oaxaca, the capital of Oaxaca. Like up and then toward, up and then left, yeah, west to Mexico City. Maybe the bus took the other route, so I made a circle there in just a few days between Christmas and New Year. So the fact that this younger brother was so attached to being home made me think that, well, home, that was a good thing, right? So maybe Carlos was very attached to his home. That's why he felt so balanced and equilibrium in a way. You might say that he had insight. But, well, after that Puerto Escondido, I kind of left him, but I don't really know how I left him because I have no clue what happened. Because I don't remember what we did, actually. The only thing I do remember is that we were at nighttime when I arrived, I think. We're standing. He was standing and next to him, all these cuates, these bros, standing at the beach next to the water. And they were smoking marijuana. Do you want some? I said, no, thank you. I did not smoke. I don't do that. And he was absent. At the time, I did not understand. It was because of the weed. He was kind of gone. I said, why did I drive all the way here? He's not with me. He was standing there. I was standing next to him, but that's it. He never made like a jest or anything. And that was strange. So I left, but I have no clue how I left. I mean, after that New Year's, when we returned. Because I would never call him. I don't remember anything. Like, it seems to me like then we just, no one called no one and that's it, we're done. I have no idea. Maybe it was different. Maybe I'm mistaken. I have no memory. That's the point. And so years later, well, he comes to my apartment with his friend, dropping in, checking in. You see, there's no drama involved either. I have no clue what happened. I don't think there was like a firm statement about anything. Neither in favor of, you know, romanticism nor against. But somehow I was like, I wasn't pissed off. I'm never pissed off. I was like, oh God, I was disappointing, for saying the least. Because shortly after I met the other guy, Tanya. And I remember when I met Tanya from in the office, I was not really interested in him because I was like exhausted. I said, I don't want to deal with another guy. Gosh, get off me. That was my feeling. And that was because of Carlos. I kind of felt a little bit like hopeless and lost and like, ugh. So he had me invested there. Now, maybe he was so protected and his mother is so giving that he did not understand to make a larger move. We hadn't read the book yet. And maybe because of some social economical thing, I don't know where that hints came from, he felt minor than the fresas, as he told me at that very visit to my apartment, that it was difficult for him not to have like a fancy car and a daddy with lots of money, but just a little beetle. And I was completely surprised. Why would it be? I mean, really? I mean, he is so much larger as a person than anybody else over there. Why would that matter to him? See, that's what it was. So perhaps, maybe, I don't know. I can look into the field. I don't know, maybe he is used to women coming onto him. I don't know, I have no idea. Or his mother taking care of things? Because I do not call. I do not, like I said, I don't take possession. I don't claim anything mine. I go with what comes to me. I only go with what comes to me. I can never do anything else. Statten da mit Salat und fette Potzen Pommes. Dieser Bombardier bin da, ich lach mich selber aus. Ich gehe arbeiten, hier tut die Fett in der Luft. Nach der Arbeit, lock mich selber ein, das ist noch der Herr. Ich die Party, dritte Etage hin, guck mal, ja. Lager, Feierabend, Partyboot, ja. Gute Laune, Kassen hier, Leute, Friday wird gefeiert. Darum kommen wir heute hier. Deine Girls sehen gut aus, don't you? Sie sind gut drauf, okay, Jay. Und ich flieh, drück die Blut an. Ich stirb, meine Friend. Hab in seiner Lächeln ewige Treue geschworen. Ich und diesen Männer talken, was mit dir und wir? Yo, stop it, do the shit, das ist mein Leben, sag ich dir. Heute Nacht ist perfekt, ganze Clique ist Sonntag, Vibe und Freak, ich geh nie wieder weg. Ich will hier sein, aber da sein. Möchte ich hier sein und dann da sein. Ich will hier sein, aber da sein. Möchte hier sein und dann da sein. Sommer mit der Nacht umgehen.